So first, a little introduction to me. My name is Kate, or I think I'm Catherine maybe on the thing, but everyone calls me Kate. I'm a software engineer actually working at IBM at the moment. I've done quite a lot on WebSphere Liberty, which is our Java application server, and then more recently been working on microservices. And that's for about the sort of last year and a half to 2 years. And a lot of that time has been spent developing something called GameOn, which I'll go into in a little bit more depth later, but not too much depth because my colleague Adam, who's just sat down here, is talking about GameOn in his talk next over in C1, I think. So if you want to know even more in depth, then do check out that talk. And if you have any questions or you want to ask me anything afterwards and you can't find me, you can always tweet me as well. So what are the contents of this presentation? So I'm first going to talk about what are microservices, just as a quick overview. Then introduce GameOn, what it is, just as kind of a setting. Then talk a bit about how you can identify a user in a microservice system, how you can protect requests, development versus production, and then a conclusion. And I just want to start by saying, I wouldn't say that I'm a security expert. I've done quite a lot with microservices, and this is really me coming to you as a developer who is suddenly in this new world of microservices where I really need to care about security, where I perhaps haven't had to think about it quite so much before. And hopefully you can take away from this not only a new platform GameOn to go and try out some security things, but also some kind of hints and tricks when you start doing security as a developer. So first, what are microservices? Can I have a general show? Who in here thinks they kind of know what microservices are already? Okay, so that's most of the room. So I'll give a very brief overview. So you feel free to go and read up afterwards. If you search microservices, there's so much stuff online. Martin Fowler has a really good website as well. And I'll link as well. I've written a Red Book, an IBM Red Book publication about its best practices for Java microservices, but the kind of general microservice message is kind of cross language. So there are just some Java specific bits in that book. So microservices used to compose a complex application using small, independent, autonomous, replaceable processes that generally communicate via language agnostic APIs. They bring a lot of advantages because now that you're deploying everything individually, you can scale them individually. You can choose to implement some parts in a different language depending on the requirements. And it means that you can build in some more sort of fault tolerance. You can really handle if one part of your system goes down, it doesn't have to take down everything. But using microservices does come with some sort of caveats. So one of these is the fact that actually with microservices, it introduces a fair bit of complexity. And I'm not going to go into depth of what those complexities are, but the sort of extra things around testing, security, which I will go into, but also like communication infrastructure that you're going to have to consider if you move to microservices. So before I kind of launch into this, I just want to say you should, you know, go away, read up about microservices, really understand why you're taking the step into microservices, and don't do it just because there's lots of people talking about it at conferences, because it is a really fun, cool new thing. But it does have its kind of advantages and disadvantages. So for this talk, I'm assuming that you've gone away, read up, and you're sure that microservices is the right choice for you. So how does this move to microservice affect security? I've got here some simple, kind of simplified pictures of a monolithic application versus a microservice application. And you can kind of see there's a fair bit of change between the two. The microservice now has more parts to it. It's got more interactions between the parts, and there's more kind of chance of things coming and going. And that's something that's just inherent to your move to microservices. And whereas in the past with a monolithic application, you might have had, for example, security as you just enter into the external gateway, and then from then on you're inside your nice secure box and you don't have to worry about the interactions between your classes or whatever. Now in the microservice world, every time a service talks to another service, there's a risk there. How do you make sure that those communications are secure? And also, how do you authenticate someone and keep them authenticated throughout the flow? And I'll kind of talk about how you can do this. But the key thing is that actually, now that all your microservices are kind of deployed separately, they don't all have necessary access to the kind of authentication class or module or whatever that you had over in the monolith. And so you've got to think about, how am I going to make sure that I can just authenticate once and then trust that I'm still authenticated as I go through the system? So that's kind of the application wise. The other thing to think about is, generally, when you've moved from monoliths to microservices, there's actually been a move of infrastructure as well. And infrastructure can play a big part in security. If you've gone from an on-prem solution where you've, you know, got everything in a nice little box and you feel very safe, if you move to a cloud environment, you need to trust your cloud provider. But also, who has access to that cloud? You know, even taking into account the fact that your applications are exposing potentially public endpoints, there might be other people who have access to the infrastructure and things. So that's something you're going to have to think about as well, which isn't as much in the scope of this talk, but it's just something to think about as you're looking at security. You need to think about the environment as well as just your application in of itself. So now I'm going to give a bit of an introduction to Game On. If you haven't heard, this is the t-shirt. Game On is a text-based adventure game that us and my team built, and the aim of it was to help people learn about microservices, but in a fun and different way. So as I said, it's text-based, so you kind of write commands in the bar at the bottom there, and you can move from room to room by things like go north, go south. And the reason it's for microservices is actually every room in Game On is a different microservice. So if I'm in a particular room, it says you're in a dark basement room, and I say go north, and it says now you're in a meadow. Those two rooms, the content from the rooms is being served by a different microservice. And those microservices are written by you guys, so by developers that come along and plug into our infrastructure. So we've written kind of the back end, and then you guys write your individual rooms and plug in. And the reason this is so powerful is because you can write one room, and hopefully that experience of writing one room shouldn't be too difficult, but then you can start to explore other concepts. So you can say, okay, well, what if I have two instances in my room? How am I going to manage the scaling and all that kind of thing? And I won't go on too much more because I'll be cutting into what Adam's going to say in his talk, but that's kind of the premise for Game On. So what were our key aims when we wanted to secure Game On? The first one was to identify the user. The second one was to prevent data alteration in transit. And then the third one was to prevent replay issues. And these are kind of the three that I'm going to talk about in the scope of Game On. And the reason that we had these particular requirements is, from our point of view, when a user comes in and registers and say they want to build a room, we need to know who they are. And we wanted to be able to say, oh, well, you know, you have access to change your room, update your room, etc. We wanted to make sure that when messages were sent between services, that we could trust that everything came through well. And the replay issues is actually one that we kind of tripped over when we first started creating Game On, because we have something called a map service, which deals with where the rooms are in comparison to each other. And one of our developers actually accidentally created like a million rooms. And we were just like, oh, okay, that was not good. So the replay issues not necessarily replay attacks, even just some system somewhere that's gone a bit rogue and started firing off requests. We wanted to be able to say, oh, we've seen this request before, we'll just chuck it out. So I'll talk about how we do that. So I talked about Game On. This is a quick picture of the architecture, just so you have a bit of an idea in your head. So you can see the map service that I mentioned. And all of these services in the middle are our kind of core services for the game. You can see the room up in the top right-hand side, and that's what you guys would build. And then we've got the static and proxy are kind of our front-end stuff, and then we've got a bunch of services along the bottom. And that's kind of just a very simplified version of what we have going on, just so you can kind of visualize when I'm talking about security. So how can you go about identifying a user? Well, when we came into this, we felt there were kind of two approaches we could take. Either we can manage the username and the password ourselves, or we can use something like social sign-on. And in the past, in a monolithic application, it might be that you had some system that was there and ready to manage your username and your password. But in this new world, not only are you now potentially, as a team, only creating one part, so you might not want to have to deal with that piece, but also you might be part of a kind of larger chain of microservices or something. So in some ways it's nice to be able to find a solution that is a bit more global, and that's where the social sign-on is quite nice, because we're working with real people, and a lot of developers out there are quite happy with using social sign-on, and we'll have hopefully at least one of these things. GitHub probably is the most likely if they're a developer, but so this is what we decided to do for Game On, and that's the actual pitch of the login page there. So let's check how much time. So this is a picture of how we authenticate with our third-party auth services, just to kind of show you the flow that you can go through in order to authenticate. So we have a request coming in from the client, and it goes across and goes to our Game On auth service, which I'll talk a little bit more in a minute. That comes back to the user and then redirects them to authorize with the third-party provider. So in this case, we're not having to implement anything to do with how they authorize themselves to say they are who they say they are. Facebook or Google or Twitter or anything, they deal with that. And then they call us back with an authorization code, and they know it's us because we've sent over a key with the user. And then we can then use that to get an access token for the developer. And this is the sort of standard OAuth 2 OpenID Connect open standards flow. And we chose to use this because A, open standards are really good, and B, it means we can use a similar flow for all these different providers. They all use the same thing. So from us and our learning standpoint, it just makes things a little bit more simple. So back to the picture of our architecture. You'll notice we had the auth service over there that I just mentioned. So the reason we have an auth service is kind of twofold. One, because we felt that actually in the future we might want to, say, create like a mobile app for Game On if it got really popular, and we don't want to have to re-implement authentication in the front end every single time. So keeping that layer of separation between your front end and what you're doing with authentication is a really good idea. The other reason is because actually we didn't want to kind of muddy the other services with information about how our third-party authentication works. If we suddenly found out that, you know, for some reason one of the third-party providers was doing something that we felt was unsecure, we want to be able to take that out as quickly as possible. So by having that auth service there, we just have to change one service. And it comes back to kind of everything that you need to think about when you go into microservices, that if you need to change something, you should only have to change it in one place. So it kind of comes back to that. So once we have the identity of the user, how are we then transporting it around? And in this case, we've chosen to use JSON Web Tokens or JWTs or JOTs, depending on who you talk to, they say to pronounce it differently. I'm going to go with JWTs today, I think. So a JSON Web Token is used to carry some representation of some information. You may have heard of them before. They're definitely not a new technology with microservices, but I think they're actually particularly useful for microservices. And they contain certain claims such as issuer, subject, and expiration time that you include inside the information. And the aim of a JSON Web Token is so that you can know that the request was initiated by a specific user and then who that user was. And when you have your JSON Web Token, you should definitely do some sort of validation. So one of the key things to validate is against time. So you'll notice there's some nice time-related fields in JSON Web Tokens that you can make use of. For example, IAT is the time that the JSON Web Token was created, MBF, not processed before, and expiration time. So you should be checking each of these. So when your web token arrives, you should say, okay, do all of these fit? And if they don't, then you need to do something about that. The other thing that we are doing is using JSON Web Signature, because we can create a JWT and pass it through. But if it turns up, how do we know that nothing within those claims has changed? And that's where the signature comes in. And you can sign a JWT with either a shared secret, so for example, using something like HMAC, so that would be a symmetric secret and you both know it, or with a public-private key pair. And this can be any public or private key pair. If you have an SSL cert with a public key, then that might be useful to you. So how do we use them in GameOn? Well, in GameOn, we're using the access token that I talked about earlier that we got for our user, and we use that in the JWT. So that's how we know who you are when the request comes in. And then we're signing it with the GameOnText.org certificate, so the SSL certificate. The reason we chose to do this is because A, it means that we didn't have to create a new public-private key pair, we can use the one we've got already. And B, our public key for our SSL certificate is very well known. So when we want to send our JSON Web Tokens to people who have a room, they can then validate that it's us. So in between our own communications, we can do other things that I'll talk about in a minute to validate that we know who we are. But it's a useful thing to be able to say to anyone, if you come and extend GameOn, then you can validate that it's us that's talking to you and not someone else. And then all the system services deal with JWTs. So for example, if you come into proxy, which is sort of the front end, and then make a request into player, we are validating the request using signed JWTs. So here's an example of just some code from GameOn. This isn't the exact code. If you want to go look at the exact code, it's all open source on GitHub. I'll put up a link at the end. But this is kind of a simplified version because the actual code's a bit longer. But you can kind of see how the JWT is created. So you set the claims up at the top there, and then you're signing it with a private key here, and then you are validating it with a public key. And the important thing to note when you validate it, which is put in a comment, but we haven't got any code for it, is that if your validation comes back that your key is not valid, then you need to throw some exceptions. The other thing to note is that there's a set header param at the top, which is setting sort of a hint to say how to decrypt or decipher what the JWT is. That should always be a hint. You might have heard there was some issues where people were passing in none and then assuming there was no sort of signing going on of the JWTs and just saying, oh, it's fine, I'll just pass it through. So you should always make sure that even if you set that as kind of like, oh, this is a hint to what I used to sign this, you should still always do the validation. So how can you protect requests? For this, we're using keyed hashed message authentication codes, or HMACs. So if you haven't heard of them, basically a HMAC is where you take the request attributes or request headers for a request, and then you hash them and use a shared secret to digitally sign the hash. And then when you pass it through at the other end, all of these attributes are then rehashed and then validated to make sure that the two things match. And for this, I think the important thing to know is what you're using for the secret. So I'll talk about GameOn a little bit more in a minute, but in GameOn, we are very careful about what we're using to sign these hashes if we're passing them around, because this is using a symmetric signature. So it means that if someone else knows what they're signing it with, then they can grab it and then put in a new sort of fake request and muck around with it. So you need to be careful what you're doing. They're used to authenticate the services and then verify that the message contents have also not been altered and to prevent replays. And I'll talk about how you can prevent replays in a minute. So this will help you protect your headers in your request. The other thing is you can actually use this to protect the body of your request as well. So you could actually take a hash of the body of your message, put that into your header, and then include that in what's then being hashed. And in that way, you can protect both the header of your request and the body of your request from kind of being messed with in transit. So HMAX in GameOn. So in GameOn, we're using them in kind of two different places. The first one is service-to-service operations. So for example, if the proxy is calling map, and this is where the thing about replays comes in. So in this case, we want to prevent people from doing replays. And there's a couple of ways you can do that. In GameOn, we're actually sort of checking all of the headers. And if we see something with the same headers, then we throw the request. And it just means that we can quickly check for a replay issue or attack as soon as the request comes in, we don't have to kind of do any other validation before we do it. So we're using that when we're going to map. And then the second one is from Mediator, who mediates and talks to rooms, but Mediator talking to a particular room, and we're signing that with a secret as well, so that the people who write rooms can validate that nothing has changed in the request that's come in. And this is where the shared secret thing comes in. So if we use the same secret between proxy and map, and then between the room and Mediator, then every single person who creates a room in Game On would have that secret and would be able to recreate requests, which is potentially very bad for us. But if we use different secrets, then we can scope kind of how much damage they can do. So we actually use an internal secret for in-between services, so proxy to map or any of the other internal Game On services that we own and we trust. Those all have their shared secret. And then between room and Mediator, when the room registers initially, they pass us a secret, and then that's what we use. And the reason this is lower risk from our point of view is because actually, if you make requests back and forth from a room, say, or if you did it like on a player scope, they can only access the data like specific to that room. They can keep putting requests in to update the name of their room or something. But from our point of view, it's less of a risk. We're happy to take on that risk that an individual player might try and muck around with requests for their specific room. So we are using shared secrets everywhere, but we are using different shared secrets because we scoped them. The other thing to note is that we're using a shared library for creating the HMAX. And we found this to be absolutely essential. We initially wrote out like a little list of how you create your HMAC so that room providers could do some sort of validation. And we quickly decided this was way too difficult. We've run workshops with Game On, and we had people kind of sitting there like, why doesn't my room work? And it was because they'd done like one tiny thing wrong. So by creating a shared library, we actually then make sure that every single service is using the same system to create their HMACs, to validate them and everything. And it just makes all our lives easier. And again, because Game On is open source, then you can go have a look at that shared library if you want to. Okay, so I've kind of talked a little bit about how in Game On we're getting the user identity and how we're kind of protecting requests as they go over the wire. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the issues we've had around development versus production. So there were two problems that I'm going to talk about. We had all sorts of things going on, but these are the two I'm going to talk about here. The first one is accessing third-party services in development. So we're very keen on the idea of, you know, being able to do as much as possible in a developer laptop and then be able to see the same results when we're up on Bluemix. And we needed to work out a nice way to kind of authenticate people when they're working locally and let them use third-party services. And in this case, we're injecting sensitive data in our DevOps pipeline. So this is kind of, I've talked a little bit about how you could need to think about your security when you're doing interactions between services, but this is more like, how do you have security outside of your core application, just in the way developers go about things and the way you implement your DevOps pipelines and things. So we could have said, oh, well, we'll just have, you know, some stuff, like some, we'll have all of the data somewhere and we'll give it to the developers because we trust them and then we'll go from there. But there's a risk of me as a developer accidentally checking something into GitHub, and then everyone can see my sensitive data for my running live system. So that's clearly not a good idea. So what we've done is we have different DevOps pipelines set up for sort of staging and production and development, and then we inject the sensitive data. And actually for Game On, rather than injecting data for every single service, because we have quite a few that we're standing up, we're actually just injecting the credentials for etcd. And then we're using etcd to then go get all of our credentials. So that was quite a nice way to kind of minimize effort for us. If we add a new, if we decide to add a new service, we don't have to go get all the credentials and put them all in the DevOps pipeline. We can just put the one in, and that works a bit easier. The other problem we came across was how to get development and production parity for SSL. And, you know, and kind of for our whole flow in terms of authenticating both the user and authenticating services with each other. We didn't want to have to share sensitive credentials with developers, especially because we wanted to be able to allow people who wanted to create apps for Game On to come in and run Game On themselves on their personal laptop. So you as an external developer to my team can come along, download all of Game On and stand it up locally. And so the way we went about this was actually setting up local key stores. So all of our applications are built and put into Bluemix, but they're in Docker containers. So when we run them locally, we can actually set up a local key store, and we have just a script that runs to do this. And it puts it in a shared Docker volume that is then shared by all of our different services, which means that then when the services are stood up and they try to make requests to each other, they all trust each other. And that just made the flow locally so much easier, because if something goes wrong, it's much easier for us to kind of see what the problem is and debug that. And if you are like interested in more of like the journey we went on for this, then, you know, do come and ask me afterwards, and like one of my colleagues I can put you in touch with went through a whole like different set of options for this, and we eventually came up with this as our kind of best example. So in conclusion, so these are the things I kind of want you to take away from today. If you move to microservices, you're going to have more interactions. And in my opinion, the main difference between a monolithic application and a microservice application is in the number of interactions. And that's where you need to really think about security for microservices. But you also have to think about environmental concerns. Where are you standing up your application? Do you trust the cloud provider? Do you trust the other people who are on the cloud? And what does that mean for security? You should use different techniques in different places. So I've talked a little bit about how, for example, we scoped our shared secrets to a specific scenario. We're actually not using HMAX, for example, everywhere. We're just using them in the places that we felt were the highest risk. And for Game On, because it is a test app and it's kind of a place to play things around, there are areas where we try out kind of different security techniques and seen, you know, actually, we're not going to do the fully fledged thing in this place, but this is the piece that we felt was important for this particular interaction. So you need to really understand kind of the interactions. Centralize using common services or libraries. So I talked about two examples where we do this. So the first one was using a centralized auth service as the kind of proxy for then talking out to all of the third-party auth providers. When we separated that out, it was originally in with Player, I think, but when we separated that out, it just made things a lot easier. And then now if we want to change things, it's going to make our life a lot easier in the future. And then the other example was using the shared library as well, which just makes sure that all of the services are doing the exact same thing. And then the final thing is do it early. This is something that I know is sometimes difficult because microservices, there's so many things to think about at once. But I really think that actually if you think about security as soon as you start writing your application, as soon as you start designing it, then you can design it in a way that will make it more secure. And it might be that you have extra constraints to consider. For example, if you have like certain data that needs to be in a certain location because of sort of government laws or things like that, then you can really build that in. With Game On, we kind of thought about it from the beginning, but we didn't do as much of the implementation until a little bit later, and we really found a bit of a struggle to kind of crowbar everything in. So definitely do it from the beginning, and that will just make your life a little bit easier. So that's all I have for you. If you want to go play Game On, then there's a link there. If you want to come and build a room for Game On, then there's also another link. We're definitely kind of trying to explore more in terms of security in Game On. So if you want to come and, you know, have like somewhere that's a little bit safer for you to try out your security kind of experiments, then do feel free to come over. And we also have a Slack channel as well that you can get to from Game On Text and come and ask us questions about what we did, or come and tell us if you think, you know, there's something that we should improve in the game. You can also go to wasdev.net if you want to learn about Liberty, which is what most of our core services are running on top of at the moment. And then there's a red book as well, which I helped to co-write. The other thing I want to mention just quickly is Game On, most of the core services are in Java, but loads of the rooms are in different languages. So if you don't want to write stuff in Java, that's fine. I happen to be a Java developer, so that's why we wrote most of the core services in Java. But feel free to come and write them in different languages. We've got some like Go ones, we've got JavaScript, etc. So that's about it for today. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
So the shared services that your core, sorry, the shared SQL,
okay, yes,
the core services, you're basically the main trust there. You're not using any kind of proxy authentication, are you? The JDBT is just a token to pass around.
Yeah, so for Game On, I'd say the main thing that we're very careful with our JWT is we thought a lot about the time that we wanted them to live. And actually for Game On, I think it's about 12 hours. Like it's quite a wide window. And the reason for that is just around what is the risk. And for us, the risk there is not that high. And so we decided to make the window quite wide. In terms of the authentication service, so we own that authentication service that's making the requests in. So once it has kind of a token there, then we're using that. There are other parts of the application where we're actually not using, we're not signing with a shared secret, we're signing with API keys as well. So there is some other kind of elements. To a certain extent, Game One is a little bit of a sort of mishmash of some security things, just because we've been trying out different things. Does that answer your question? Yeah?
Slightly off topic. You said you're using Docker containers.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask what orchestration tools and what config management tools you're using
to
deploy, that kind of thing?
Yeah, so to stand them up locally, at the moment we're mostly using Docker Compose to then get everything stood up. We also are using Vagrant as well, because we have a front-end developer person who kind of comes over from a different team to help us out every now and again, and she wasn't keen on learning how to use Docker, so she uses the Vagrant stuff. So that's how we're signing up locally. Adam can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe when we're pushing them up to Bluemix, we're then standing them all up just using IBM Container Services. The piece we haven't added into Game On yet is the scaling, and I think that's what you're asking about, orchestration. And
yeah.
I think we'll hopefully be looking at something like Kubernetes maybe,
sure.
But we haven't got that in yet, so we haven't decided. So if you have any thoughts on, you know, what is a good approach, then feel free to come and, you know, give us that input. It's definitely a work in progress. The thing we've definitely learned from Game On is that there's so many different things to think about in microservices. And so we've kind of been trying to like tick them off, but orchestration of containers, we haven't quite got there yet.
Thank you.
Did you want to go back there or?
Yeah. Well, I've got the microphone then. So a sort of related question about this is how you track requests between services. I saw you had ELK in the corner of that diagram.
Yes.
It seems to be quite a tricky problem, is tracing requests. Can you just talk a little bit about, I mean, I don't want you to anticipate what anything your colleague would say, but can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so we're actually, when requests come through, they're all being logged and put into Logstash. So we have Logstash hosted in Bluemix. And then we can use things like Kibana and Grafana on top of that service in order to kind of work out where things are going through. Again, I think this is an area that we've kind of only just scratched the surface. We've got things going into Logstash, and we're using Elasticsearch there, but we haven't fully kind of stepped forward and worked out how we're really going to use those. So that's kind of, we've kind of put in the infrastructure without quite getting to the point of like fully understanding how everything's moving around. I think there was a question up at the back.
So with JWT, is that going kind of outside the boundary of your network, i.e. to the client? And if so, have you had any thoughts about revocation? It's always a kind of criticism that's levelled against JWT.
Yeah, well, in terms of like revoking the... Yeah. So for all of the... I'm not sure off the top of my head if we're actually currently doing any outbound. If we are, it'll be to the rooms. And again, it's the thing we have really thought about in each individual place where we're using it. We've gone in and thought, right, what is the risk here? And what is that time window going to be? And what will the impact be on the user if I shorten the time frame or if I lengthen it? And I think with a lot of these things, it's kind of getting that balance and understanding what are the risks. Because as you say, if it goes outside of our kind of set of services that we know and trust, then there is a risk there. And if we're making requests outwards, then we can just shorten that time frame, which makes it easier then to revoke things. The other thing to note is that if we're signing them with things like API keys, then we can do something there and revoke API keys.
Have you built a threat model? And if so, have you published it?
We have not built a threat model. If you have any knowledge about how to go about that, then again, I would really welcome any input. The kind of security-wise, we've kind of approached it from we're a set of developers who haven't necessarily done a lot with security before. And so we've kind of taken our first little steps. And I think the areas that we still need to kind of look into is the kind of the risk assessment in terms of not just us understanding the transaction, but a more kind of active, like, what are the risks if we do things like a look at all the threats from the outside rather than us just understanding our interactions. Is there any more questions?